It is June 22nd. We'll call the Hadley School Committee meeting to order. First order of business is approval of the minutes. I had to find my way. Has anyone reviewed?
Motion to approve the minutes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any changes, corrections, deletions? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Wow, I really should put on my glasses. What were the adjustments to the agenda?
The only leadership report will be from me. Mr. Beck will not be with us this evening. Administrators won't be with us this evening.
All right.
I told them to take a night off.
And then we just need to add the approval, the vote approval.
Yes, that's under presentation. So do we have any presentations other than that? So the only presentation we have, the only announcement we have, is that we have voted to endorse the Unit A contract. Unit A ratified the contract earlier this week, last week, whenever. They ratified,
last week on
they ratified
Wednesday.
The contract. We were in executive session earlier and also approved the contract. And do I need to do another roll call vote? Or that just announcement is it? All right. Public comment. We have no public here today.
We have no public comment.
We are on agenda item number 7.
Wow.
Did you see how we did that?
That was fast.
Whoa.
Love it. So I will start my report as I always do, recognizing our faculty. I have recognized Mr. Mish and his staff at other times during the year, but at the end of the school year, they do so much work to set up events and break down events, and most of us just appreciate the fact that all the chairs are there and everything looks great, and don't think that there's somebody racing about doing that for us and for our students and for the public. So thank you to all of them. And I would like to say a special thank you to our administrative support team. Corey Feltovic, Heather Poyer, Nancy Fogarty, Caitlin Lord, Dee Rex, and Joni Wolfshauser. They all worked with me to develop procedures and processes that have improved communication, workflow, and student safety. Earlier this year, I talked with the school committee about the various ways that we were using Google Docs in order to ensure that all the administrators and all the advisors had access to student emergency contact information, and that all of the chaperones on field trips, that their contact information was in Google Drive so that I could see it, the administrators could see it. And these are small things, but previously they were really organized, excellent. We've always had organized, excellent advisors, but they were carrying all that information with them. So you can imagine all kinds of scenarios where you would want people off-site to have immediate access to that information. And it certainly helps on field trips as well. So they have put together some additional field trip procedures to streamline the process, make sure all the forms are signed, all the liability waivers, permission slips, and that information is getting home to parents, that nurses are on board, and that students get the food they need when they go off site.
Are we talking about that more, the field trip that you included?
I did include some of the procedures, and certainly we are looking for, that's part of this report, any feedback that the school committee might have about those procedures. These aren't policies. These are just letting you know all the things that happen as we go through a field trip, if there's anything you think we haven't thought of. So that's, and obviously in recognition, and I'd like to thank all of our students, and I would like to thank our teachers. I had a lovely day today with the Hadley Elementary faculty. They said goodbye to students and hello to summer. And thank you to the Hadley Elementary faculty because they gave me a lovely flower, which was very nice to thank me for my first year here. I appreciate that, or it's actually a big plant. And I wish them the best. I have had a great year in terms of how I feel every day going to work. I love the children here. I love the faculty. I enjoy coming to work every day. It's just an awesome job.
And us?
And yes, and you guys. So that was not very politically astute of me. Yes, you will be doing my evaluation next month. Oh, yeah, and you guys too. Yeah, you're right. So it's just been, it's been great. It's been really great. So thanks to everybody for that. And the parents and community members, I like going to events. I enjoy talking with people in the community. It's been wonderful.
Well, I'll just say thank you for coming to the sixth grade celebration and shaking
that
everybody's hands
fun.
As they got their little certificates.
I saw some great photos.
Yeah,
that
some
was
great
fun.
Photos. So the kids
really
had
fun.
A really nice time.
And it's nice training for graduation. So they, I unfortunately was at an off-site meeting during their rehearsal. They did have a rehearsal for sixth grade celebration. For graduation, they rehearse every day for about a week.
For a week.
We really get serious about it. That handshake is important.
It is, yes.
It's a moment. So the sixth graders don't get as much of that, but that's their first training before they go to the serious week-long McKenzie graduation handshake camp that comes when you're a senior.
Uh-huh.
That's right.
Don't forget to smile.
That's what I say. Your parents are bawling, you're smiling, they're bawling. Shake. Very good. It was excellent. I also have in your packet and in the report, I know it's hard to read, I fit it all on one page, and it's just an example. This is kind of that student achievement data snapshot. And what you see here, there's no identifying information about students, but you get a sense of the kind of growth that we've seen in reading in our first grade. These are really powerful data. And it demonstrates a few things. One, I wanted the school committee just to see the kind of impact that our educators have on student learning. So what you see, this is a test called DIBELS, and I'm not going to remember what that acronym stands for. But you see the kinds of reading skills that are assessed: letter naming, phoneme segmentation, nonsense words. Letter naming mid-year turns into oral reading. So they start looking for a child's ability to read out loud, still phoneme segmentation and nonsense words. And when students come into first grade, the color red indicates that they're below level, yellow that they're approaching, and green that they're at or above. And you just looking at the color see what happens in terms of growth over the course of a year. And we in one of our classrooms, 12 students entered below reading level, and there were zero at the end of the year below. That's really incredible, really incredible. And I also wanted you to see this because these are the kinds of what I refer to as a data dashboard, and there's a math one behind it, that we will do for every grade. I even started talking to someone at the high school about what might this look like at the high school, what kinds of data. It's a little bit harder if there is not... So we don't want to use MCAS. These are formative and benchmark assessments that we're using, and not summative autopsy type assessments that we're using. So, and in some cases, there aren't a lot of standardized tests. I was speaking to a history teacher at the high school level, and certainly we can have teacher-created assessments, and those are very useful. But this teacher also was craving something like DIBELS, a standardized measure, but we've started that conversation about what it would look like. So you can expect to see as a school committee kind of these data snapshots at every meeting throughout the year as we build them. You can expect to see this kind of information about how students are doing. Math was a little bit trickier. You have two first grade classrooms, and the average score there in October, it's topic two. Topic one in mathematics is usually really a basic recap. And topic two is where, kind of October, if the rubber hits the road in first grade, things get serious, and you know you're in for something. It's not kindergarten anymore. And so then you see what happens on topic 16. And what's powerful about this is that this is not pre-post data. We're not looking at the same test. But it still is really powerful because the topics get this, the material gets more difficult. And that's also true of the reading data that you saw. So it's even more powerful when you see all of the green in June, because it's not the same skills in phoneme segmentation being tested every single time. The skills are getting progressively difficult. So the growth is almost, in some ways, even greater, if that makes sense, in terms of what you're thinking in your mind. We're not testing the same set of skills. It's gotten progressively more challenging. This is just our start in math. We use Envision in math, and so we took the class averages, but you see the class average really grew significantly in both classes. So it's really great work in grade one. So acknowledging the teachers and showing you what you can expect. And we will also, we started kind of a tiered intervention model in grade one, introduced learning centers, very grateful for the exceptional classroom assistants that we have that support learning for students. They were working with small groups of students, clustering students around skill needs, and that obviously had a very positive effect. And Mr. Udall and his teachers have visited Buckland Shelburne Elementary, where they have a very well-developed, what's called response to intervention. So based on assessment data, you determine the kinds of skills that students need the most intensive work on, and you create assignments and cluster students according to those. This isn't some form of tracking. All students are together, but you design your centers in such a way that students can really get intensive support for specific skills. Mm-hmm. So Buckland-Shelburne has an excellent RTI model. That's the acronym, Response to Intervention. They actually saw their school levels, I want to say they went from like a 3 to a 1, but I'd have to verify that. So they saw a pretty positive impact on their overall school performance when they implemented this. We had a cohort of teachers from HES go visit Buckland-Shelburne. They went back again and sat in on what's called a data day, where the teachers look at all the assessment data and then determine what intervention students should get next. And the principal has offered to come down and work with our staff. We're looking at building out RTI, so we're hoping these kinds of results that you're seeing will keep going in other grades. And there are positive results in other grades. I just have to build the documents for every grade. The field trip procedures are in there. I don't know if school committee had any ideas. And this is really just nitty-gritty procedural things.
My only comment is that it feels like this is a lot of steps. Yes. And that maybe a statement in the beginning that says it will take you on average X number of days to get through this, so plan ahead.
That's true, yeah.
Because I don't have any sense how long it takes, but it seems like it could be weeks, months.
And are these necessarily new steps, or is this current practice?
It is current practice, and in some cases we've added things, like ensuring that all emergency information is on the Google Drive was brand new this year.
Smart.
And so in some cases we've added things. Some things already existed. We've tried to make it as similar as between both buildings, so these are just district practices. And a lot of this is handled by the administrative assistants. And it's also just to allow them to have this checklist to make sure, was the nurse consulted? Did we look at any IEPs, if that's applicable? Do we have all the medications we need? Do we have the food we need? But you're right about the timeline, is that I think there's one place on here where we say, please get something to us, but I think that has to do with food,
like
so we can add it.
Right,
the
Cori
forms.
Has
to be, you know,
and the chaperones. You have to know your chaperones at least a week in advance. So you you do have to do some
advanced planning.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's what I meant by this.
I knew where you were going with that hand gesture. I really like documenting this from the standpoint of cross-training, especially in light of how taxing some of our administrative staff can be, and that this could really help ease the load if they're filling for one another.
Mm-hmm. And then we have the award for business management services. So we had a proposal that we put out for business management services, and the management solution submitted a non-price proposal and a regular proposal. They were asked to submit, all proposers were asked to submit both. And they met all the criteria. So what you see in your packet are the company that submitted the proposal, the amount is over a 3-year period, and then the X's indicate did they meet all of the criteria that they had to in the non-price proposal. And so this requires a vote of the school committee, and it would be to award, if the school committee so chose, to award the contract for business services to the management solution for fiscal year 16. And the fiscal year 16 amount is $59,500 with an option to renew in fiscal year 17 at $59,500 and fiscal year 18 at $61,000. Those amounts are in the superintendent's report under contract for business services. And this piece of paper in your packet, this is video, just demonstrates that they met all of the criteria.
I don't know that that paper was in our packet, the criteria.
Oh, I apologize for that.
But was that amount both fiscal year 16 within our budget amount?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And is this how we did it last time? Do we have to take a vote every year to renew? I don't remember us doing that.
No, your vote would be with the option to renew.
And
so
then you have authority to renew, or does it come back to
before.
Us? I just don't remember us
it's
doing that.
The school committee's higher, so it'll probably go back to you.
All right,
so
we should just remember to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it wouldn't be going out to bid again.
No, but I just don't remember us doing it the last couple of years, which makes me think maybe we are happy to have you.
I think it did happen once.
Okay.
But I just don't remember. I don't think it happened every year, though.
I don't either. Okay. So you will vote to renew annually because it is your contract.
And it's a July 1st start?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I would take a motion.
So wait, just to understand, so this is a 3-year proposal, renewable each year, and this comports with previous years? How long has this type of contractual relationship existed?
Since 2012.
Okay.
October 2012.
And as Heather asked, this was essentially in the parameters of what we budgeted?
Correct.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Motion to approve the bid. Of $59,000 for fiscal year 16.
$59,500,
thank you. For, is it total management?
TMS?
TMS, total management.
The management solution.
Mm-hmm. Seconded.
Any other questions or discussion?
No, thank you.
No, our life has been changed.
I know.
From the adoption of good business management practices.
It's been changed for the better.
So it's been a great 3 years. I'm looking forward to a fourth.
All in favor?
Aye.
Welcome back.
So we only have a couple of more things. Summer homework, parents are asking, although this is information that both Mr. Udall and Mr. Beck have communicated to parents. So summer homework is recommended, not required.
Wow. That's
yes.
Huge.
That was a very quiet
celebration.
Is that good?
And both schools have provided information to families about how they can support their children during the summer. And of course, at the high school, students will receive information and their families about preparation for AP courses. But again, this is recommended, not required. And all that the schools are trying to do is to make sure that students are as prepared as possible so they don't start.
Even for AP, it's not required?
I think everything we're calling recommended, not required. But I will say, as I say that aloud, I think it would be a grave error not to walk into an AP class doing...
What?
If you're in AP, just do what's recommended.
Yes.
Recommended and required are synonymous when you're in AP.
Yes.
So
right.
You just are started at a disadvantage if you don't prepare. The athletic self-study... So we have responded to, that's Mr. Beck, Mr. Sednick, Ms. Bannock, and I have responded to the self-study questions. We have one confirmed person for our site visit. We have two other people who have indicated they're about 99% committed, a principal and a retired superintendent who's very active with MIAA, and then we have a commitment from an assistant superintendent who his skills would really help us with the Title IX part of it. He used to work for the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education as an auditor and is trained as a lawyer. And we will not be doing our site visit until at the earliest over the summer, and that's because these people are providing us their time for free. And so we have to work around their schedule because they're doing us a favor.
And what's the survey data being collected?
And then we'll use the surveys. We'll send surveys using that Connecticut model of surveys to parents, to athletes, to coaches.
Okay.
And give that to the people who come to visit as well.
Okay. And that parents should expect to see that over the summer.
Yes.
Okay.
And we will have a leadership team retreat on July 8th. And our goal there is to reflect on how the year went, make adjustments and set goals going forward, and to begin drafting a district strategy document. That's where you would see 3 to 5 kind of large objectives or what's our district strategy for achieving our vision, and then start thinking about what are some initiatives and work plans that would support that strategy. We'll start talking about it we've been talking about it through improvement goals and our conversations this year, but we'll start drafting that toward a simple one-page, here's the 3 to 5 big rocks we're hoping to move over the next 3 to 5 years. We would bring that back to the school committee for conversation, and of course to all of our staff and to the union, and get feedback from everyone. And certainly, school committee, if any of you would like to join us, it is during the day on July 8th, just let me know. You are all welcome to participate in the conversation. And we have our personnel report, and always sad to see folks move on. So we will miss Lori Challenger, who's our LPN and paraprofessional LPN, and Janet Slocum, our physics teacher at Hopkins Academy, is resigning this year, and we will certainly miss Miss Slocum. She's just a wonderful human being. And of course, Joni is working 100% at her other job, and we wish her well, and I already miss her. But I survived, Joni, if you're watching. I survived today. I made it. She's going to come check in on me. And that's all we have.
And do you have anything to say on behalf of Mr. Beck, Mr. Udall, Ms. Bell?
I don't really. Okay. There was nothing pressing, so they can bring all of their updates to you.
It was a lovely graduation.
It was nice, wasn't it? It was really nice.
We're up to Chris already.
Zipping right along.
We are.
Okay, so the first item we have is the expense report. Kind of a placeholder here because it's only 13 days from this report until the end of the year, but nevertheless, just shows where we are. Still in good shape, obviously. We'll spend it right down. I can move money in and out of a couple of accounts that we use if we have any extra money or if we come up short, the circuit breaker account. I can also, because we can carry over what the amount we made last year, which is about $94,000. So if we have a lot of room there, we can also move it in and out of the school choice account, actually, if we want to. So
no concerns or unexpected challenges?
None that I can see, no. So we're in good shape there.
It's been quite a year.
Is this the first year where I didn't say we're in rough shape?
Exactly. Yes, it is.
So. I demand optimism in the central office.
Let's see. What was next on the agenda? Revolving accounts. So in your package, there's a list of revolving accounts. I did not get the balances for April 30th. So I basically carried them over from March 31st, but then May 31st, you can see we have the actual balances again. They're obviously very busy at the town hall at this point in time. There's no assistant treasurer, who also served as the assistant accountant, apparently. So that position isn't there, and so Gail is scrambling, and they're packing up to move out because they're doing asbestos removal at the town hall. So I told her the May 31st figures were much more important at this point in time than the April 30th.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
You can see not a lot of change really in most of the accounts. Student activity, obviously, by the end of the year, you can see it coming down. April 30th was probably somewhere in the middle of the 97,000 and the 50,000. So the only account that's in the negative, and it's no surprise, of course, is the lunch account. I can give you the amount now if you guys would like that. I think we need to transfer it to bring it back up. Or I can wait.
Give us a sense.
$10,000.
Really?
Transferred it from the operating budget?
From school choice.
Oh, from school choice.
To get us to zero.
It's hard to know where we're going to finish the year. Diane made a lot of collections, actually, in the last week or so.
She's done a good job.
And she's still chasing some down. But with you can see it's been $7,000, $8,000,
yeah.
Really. It's at $7,800 here. So I'm thinking, okay, with $10,000, last year we transferred a bunch of expenses out of the lunch account, and we started the year with $95 as
right.
a balance. this will give us a little bit of wiggle room anyway from the $95 we started with, because as you can see, first couple of months we were looking okay, and then it went downhill pretty quickly after that. So the $10,000 is just my recommendation. If you guys have any other thoughts.
But you don't need a vote on that now. We can, or do you? We'll do that after.
Because the next meeting is in late July.
Oh, right. All right.
The town will already be closing the books at that point.
So equipment maintenance, equipment repair, anything needed over the summer?
Diane mentioned to me today that there was a freezer or refrigerator and freezer at HES that was acting up, but it was actually the energy improvement component that was installed, so I'm just going to call them up and tell them that it's not working right, and so I don't anticipate any expenses for that, and that was all she said. So she's still waiting for that buffalo chopper. It's probably probably high on her list, but
yeah.
Other than that, no, I think everything's actually functioning right now.
Is any of that equipment on the capital planning list? Like, I just don't know what kinds of things show up on.
I don't think so.
Well, we had, of course, the famed buffalo chopper. But
yes.
We also had a new serving line with drains. Mm-hmm.
Right.
At Hopkins Academy. What was the other one?
We have grease traps.
Well, the,
oh.
The grease traps are kind of a constant thing that the town would like us to install. It's very expensive, though. We're talking, you know, $20,000, $25,000. And it's not something that neither Jeff Mish nor Diane think we need to install, because the strict guidelines of, you know, the food services here are different than, say, you know, an Italian restaurant or something. So the grease is significantly less than you'd see at, you know, a lot of other places. So we're kind of sticking with that at this point in time. But they might be on there as well, just as kind of a reminder that it's always brought up to us. And Diane is working on getting estimates on the remaining couple of items that she had on there. So she's requested them, we just haven't received them yet.
So is the goal that lunch revolving account is really around food costs, and should be, you know, typically counterbalanced by whatever is paid by families for lunch?
Yes, it's supposed to be self-sustaining.
Right.
In a perfect world.
Yeah.
I can tell you that. Well, the two other districts I do are also in the same boat.
Yeah.
So, and, you know, across the state, I'd be willing to bet there are more districts losing money in the lunch program than actually still making money.
Yeah, the economics just don't add up how it's supposed to be self-sustaining in light of the cap on what you can charge.
Right.
And the expenses related to capital equipment that we have to incur.
Right.
We just can't get out of it.
So we raised it last year, lunch. Should we be looking at raising it again this year?
Well,
that's item number two on my yellow paper. You're stealing my thunder. Yeah, I spoke with Diane today. $2.70 is the lunch, the amount that we charge for lunches. That is the amount, that's the cutoff with the state. If you're less than $2.70, you have to increase it by about, I think it's 4.19%. Brings it up to $2.82. We are at 270, so we don't need to increase it, but Diane mentioned, let's see here, eggs and poultry will not be received from the USDA next year, so she's going to have to pay market price for them, and she asked if you would consider increasing the price to 275. We're going to have to increase it next year, I assume, you know, based on what we're charging, but she thinks rather than have something like a 15-cent increase in 1 year, the 275 would help offset a little bit of the increased cost that she's seeing, and kind of be a stepping stone for the next increase as well.
When's the last time we had an increase?
It was just last year, actually.
So should we expect small annual increases?
I really think so. And to be honest, you know, a nickel increase is no guarantee that it's actually going to break even or make money next year. Because, you know, again, I mean, it's...
No, well, I think we should just assume it's not.
Yeah.
It's definitely not.
I mean, really, you know, it had started out years ago with, say, $60,000 in the account, and it was steadily going downhill ever since, to the point of where it got to zero and then below. So it was really kind of living off what it had made years ago when it was actually possible, I think, to pull this off. And there came a point in time where, you know, those reserves were depleted. And this is where we're at now. So, yeah, I think that's a pretty safe assumption. And actually, Diane, I've reported throughout the year, it's been hovering, what, about $1,000 or so that's been delinquent? She's down around $200 to $300 now, so
wow.
She's been chasing this. I mean, she really has. So, you know, that's a significant decrease. I think there were two kids at HES that were all that was left. So, she's still working on those.
So, if we do increase it 5 cents a meal, what's that going to raise on average over the year?
That's a very good question, and I have to be honest, I don't know how many lunches she serves. I really have to find that out. I can't even guess how many that would be, because there's so many kids that don't get lunch. You know, bring in their own lunch, or, you know, whatever the case may be. So, and even that fluctuates. You know, sometimes kids bring their lunch, sometimes they like what's being served. So that's kind of tough. I can certainly get that information. And this isn't something we need to do now, because lunches won't start again until the end of August. So I can get that information for next month and bring it back.
But the impact on each family would be only $9 if you got lunch every day.
Yeah, it's not a huge amount.
For the
year.
It'd be $9 for the year for a family that is purchasing lunch. $9 per year per child for a family assuming purchasing lunch every day. And assuming you're paying the full amount, mm-hmm. right? We have families who are eligible.
18% of our population who is eligible for free and reduced rent.
Correct. Right. So there are some people who don't pay the full amount.
Right. In light of the small study that the Hopkins Academy students did of the lunchtime, the mealtime experience, I wonder whether the added income would also help improve quality through greater purchasing power, and that might actually, you know, attract more lunch patrons, potentially.
Yeah, it's really a struggle with this, because again, with the guidelines that she has to adhere to, you know, just the switch from white to wheat bread was just a catastrophe for the kids, you know, all of a sudden.
Was the white pasta to multigrain pasta that just threw them over the edge.
Yeah.
That was it, right there.
I'm thinking of Mr. Simmons' graduation speech. A catastrophe.
Yes.
From white to wheat.
Yes.
When I was on the school committee in Ware, they did a partial switch where they had half the sandwich in white and half in wheat.
Wow.
And the kids ripped off the wheat, threw it away, folded the white in half, and ate that. So, I mean, it was just, you know, we couldn't win. And so that's, you know, that's part of the thing where, you know, most of this wheat bread tastes just like white bread at this
yeah.
point in time, but nevertheless, they hear the word wheat and just, oh, you know, kids don't like that. So, but, you know, I know that she has taken surveys with the kids, you know, which meals do you like, which don't you like, and, you know, if there are meals that they like, she tries to feature them more often in the month than, you know, they did before. You know, it's really kind of tough. I mean, you know, if the kids had their way, they'd have pizza every day or something. Obviously, I mean, I see some of the things she serves. It's kind of interesting, because she does expose them to, you know, different foods, mm-hmm. which is certainly good.
Maybe for the next time we meet, one question about another expense that comes up with the lunch is that when you pay through the My School Box, or whatever it was called, My Lunch Box, there's a surcharge.
Mm-hmm.
And is there any way to reduce that surcharge with that company?
Sure.
I mean, because every time you reload, it's a buck.
$2.
Yeah, $2.95. So I get it. Prices will go up, and we'll be reloading potentially a little bit more often.
Yep.
Or you pre-charge a bigger amount,
right.
So you don't have to do it more often. But that would be another source of just, mm-hmm. if we can at all impact that. Like,
sure.
If you lower that 5 cents, then we're good.
Yeah,
right.
Okay.
That's a good point.
And the only other thing I'd ask, Chris, is if we could do a little, if there's any thought on how other districts are dealing with the continuing and growing deficit. No, it's not ideal for us to go into choice to pay it off every year. And so some thinking on how we plan ahead for FY17 budgeting, I don't know.
And if there aren't
other places, because I just can't think off the top of my head of where they might be. So there aren't other places to get that money from, to make the transfer from. Do we at least take that into consideration when we're talking about the amount of money we're using from school choice?
Right.
To offset the budget, right?
So it sure seems like this has been exhausted, and at this point, unless we make a dramatic increase to the lunch price, a quarter or something, we're going to be back here every year. That's right.
Right.
And of course, the problem with raising it that much is then people just say, well, I can send the kid in with a sandwich for much less. So it's that fine line. You know, you need to raise the price, but if you raise it too much, you're going to serve, you know, too few meals. So.
Right. Which will create a bigger problem in terms of expenses over revenues, because if you don't hit some form of break even, you need a certain number of people working in the kitchen. You need, so you can't afford for your volume to go down too much, or you'll have a problem. So. And I think as the school committee recognizes that it's really, others may disagree with me, but the lunch program is really not designed to be an entrepreneurial activity for the schools. The primary purpose of the lunch program is to ensure that students have adequate nutrition so they can learn well.
Right.
And that's
break even every year.
That would be hopeful. That would be great. It's hard to do, but that certainly would be, and I think Chris is correct. I can't think of a single school district that I know of that does not have a lunch program in the red.
Which is why it seems like when we're doing our budgeting, we should just acknowledge that and build it in.
Yeah, we could.
Build something in.
Okay.
So you need a motion.
Two motions.
One is if we are ready to recommend a price increase of school lunch by a nickel from 270 to 275, or if you want to wait on that and have Chris bring back more information. And the second is a motion to move $10,000 from school choice to cover an expected approximate $10,000 deficit, give or take, from the school lunch revolving fund. What's your pleasure on?
I think I'd rather go with the school choice vote now, and you can tell us next meeting what the exact amount is, and then let's talk about the increase next meeting with a little bit more information, knowing that it may need to be 5 cents or more.
Okay.
That's fine with me.
Cool. Is a question too, is the milk price is a separate price. Is that, like if you only get milk and you don't get lunch, is that also on the table here for increasing that price?
I can ask her thoughts on that as well, actually.
Okay.
Not to mention the Dorito price.
The Dorito.
My kids will sometimes reach for the Doritos over the lunch, and there's no safety on that.
Right. That's true. Okay.
You could charge $5 for Doritos.
Dorito surcharge.
All right. I'll make a motion to approve the use of school choice funds to offset the negative balance in the school lunch revolving account.
Of not an up to. You'd like it to be $10,000.
Of.
Yes.
Utilize $10,000 of school choice funds to offset the negative balance in the school lunch account.
That was lovely.
It was.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Great.
Okay.
Next.
I have the grant report.
Yep.
You have in front of you. Basically, we have circuit breaker that we can carry over, as I mentioned, I think $94,000 and change. So, right now we have $8,000 remaining in that account. A couple of other grants, the Title IIA and the Title I. The amounts remaining in those are the amounts that we have to pay for MTERS, so we will make those payments before the end of the month, and those will be completed. The health grant has $55 left. I went over it with Renee, and she does have some supplies that she's purchasing to use up all, but I think about $2.45, I think, and you can carry over up to $10, so that will be all that's remaining in the health grant, and the early childhood, the 298 grant, will be spent by the end of the year as well. So that's all that's left for the grants at this point.
And do either of you have any sense of the upcoming state budget and how grants, discretionary or non-discretionary grants, are looking?
So I understand at the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education that all funds are kind of lumped together now, whereas last year, different departments were given allocations that they could then turn into competitive grants or requests for example, this year, one source of funding that we got wasn't really technically a grant, we applied to be a vendor with the state. That's where we created that handbook for our educator evaluation system. Next year, all the money is just in one clump. And the departments first at the state, it's my understanding, will kind of, for lack of a better term, fight over it. And then they'll determine what they're going to do with discretionary and competitive grant opportunities. I'm not very optimistic that there'll be a lot of grant money available. I am very grateful that this community is incredibly generous. I should have put this in my report. I did have the opportunity to meet with the members of the 350th committee who are in the process of or who have acquired a nonprofit tax ID number. And they are taking the money left over from the 350th and establishing an education foundation. So it is awesome and humbling when you think about the Board of Trustees, Helping Hearts, Hadley Mothers Club, PTO, and now an education foundation. I'm grateful for that because discretionary and competitive grants at the federal and state level are very, very hard to come by. I say all that, I'm very appreciative. And of course, we still have an obligation to fund our schools and not rely on philanthropy to fund our schools. All of these groups are committed to activities that support enrichment and enhancement, and we should certainly never think of their funds as supplanting the operating budget in any way. They should always be about supplementing. I think that's an important point, especially when we think about technology. I would argue that it's a responsibility of the community of the schools to fund replacement schedules, capital costs, that, again, philanthropic partners should be viewed as opportunities to supplement, not supplant.
And the last item we have is the electronic signatures for the warrant. I ran it by Gail at the town hall, who was a little iffy on it, so she reached out to our auditors, who basically did not like the idea either.
Aren't our auditors Mellons and Heath?
Yes.
The same auditors that told the Franklin Regional Council of Governments we should get electronic signatures for warrants?
Yeah, they didn't like the fact that, you know, as they put it to me, school committee members should be going through the entire warrant, not just the printout of all of the expenses, but the actual bills themselves. And they didn't feel comfortable with just, you know, with everyone just getting the printout. And I did tell them, well, they could email us and request a copy of a particular bill to be scanned and sent to them. But she just kind of felt that it's unlikely that people would necessarily do that. So that was where it was left, basically. So, I mean, I can reach out to them again. I was kind of surprised myself, which is why we went back and forth, you know, a few times. But if you'd like, I can certainly give it another try.
Well, I think that part of the discussion was there are times it would be easier for school committee members, but also just at the number of days we have to turn around the signatures. And so if we can't do electronic signing, then we will probably ask that somehow we have more time to sign the warrant. And I don't know how you accomplish that.
Yeah, right now the goal is always to have them done on Friday so that people can stop in over the weekend.
Yep.
Sometimes there's just something that's holding it up, you know, whether it be we didn't get all of people's time cards in time. You know, I mean, there's always something,
yep,
it seems, that comes up like that. And so it just delays it until Monday. And, of course, you guys lose a valuable weekend to be able,
right,
to stop in. So
I agree with the spirit of wanting school committee members to not be so hands-off that we're just signing and not seeing. So there's got to be a way to enable that without creating this massive electronic forwardable thing. It's got to be a, I mean, I don't know what that solution is, but I can't imagine that we're the first ones thinking about.
Well, no, really, we did change it at our organization, and our executive committee members regularly ask for copies of invoices, and we just scan them and give them the information. So I find this a little surprising.
What if it wasn't regularly requesting, but rather as a common practice to just scan it and send it?
Although, so then that would become...
It's a pretty massive document.
This is, yeah, right. These are your invoices that you signed tonight that I bring for you.
Plus, we have many sizes of invoices. Some people have little things.
So that would be the...
It took quite a while.
Doesn't that have to work its way around the system anyways to ensure that teacher X, who ordered product Y, received it on such and such a date, that quantity, et cetera?
Oh, you're saying that the efficiency of electronic could...
Scan it once, get the approvals, collect that same PDF for ultimate school committee sign-off. There's got to be a way to streamline this. I'm happy to help think about what that is, but I can't imagine that this is something that hasn't been thought of and done.
Do we want to do it only with the payroll one? I mean, because that's every other one, and the whole schedule is right behind it. It's very clear. It wouldn't involve scanning. Mm-hmm. I mean, at least it gives us a... One out of two ain't bad, you know.
And that's usually the one that causes the delay, too, would be the payroll one. So,
And the one where if we have people on direct deposit, the warrant needs to be signed.
Oh, yeah. It absolutely does.
So
maybe, Christy, mind circling back around just if it were payroll because the documentation is already sent. And certainly I am open also, if you, Meredith, thinking about this, I got to be honest with you, same thing. I am thinking of every school committee I've been to, every meeting, and it's a massive invoice binder. Nobody is doing that electronically. Even on paperless PO systems, it may be that they're acknowledging receipt of the items, but the actual invoice is still...
And maybe...
Auditors still look for those big binders for every fiscal year. And I just don't know of a place that doesn't have the invoice box.
All right, so we're not giving up.
What's that?
We're not giving up.
We're going to phase in.
No, I mean, I like the payroll idea. That's
halfway.
Right. And really, I mean, what do you look at with that? You just have the sheets really to look at.
I mean, you just look for anything that might be out of the ordinary.
I mean, you don't see the timesheets or anything, right?
No, never. It's by person, hour, or rate, total payment. Okay. And any kind of side notes are on there. I think we have one here.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah, I can run it by her. I really wouldn't expect that that one would be a problem at all, so.
Even that would be helpful. Mm-hmm.
You done?
I am done, yes.
Excellent. We are on to school committee reports. One of the things we talked about is whether we wanted to start these meetings earlier at 5:30 or maybe 6 o'clock. I asked people to think about it and get back to me. I think you said 5:30 you could do. Roby said yes. You guys were...
I just can't do executive session before that.
Right.
I'm willing to give it a try. It might be a problem sometimes, but I can come up with alternate scenarios to support.
Well, can we try it for July?
Yeah,
and
like
if it
to.
Becomes a complete hassle for you, you'll tell
thank
us
you.
And we will be
that
flexible
be
back.
Yes, thank you.
All right, does that work?
Sure.
What time would this be?
Starting at 5:30 and starting in July. That's July.
Start the meeting before 6. I can't hear it live. Our policy, anything before 6 doesn't get aired live because it's a screwy time.
But we're not often not live, right?
No, we're always live.
No.
Including right now.
This is right now.
But people would still have the opportunity to see the school committee meeting. They simply just wouldn't see it live. Mm-hmm. So people would still have the option to see it, and I am pretty good at getting draft minutes up to the school committee and on the district website within 48 hours. So the public should know that typically, don't hold me to that because that's beyond what the law expects, but I want to say pretty consistently, except for one time, had them to you within 48 hours of the meeting. So the public can go on our website, see draft minutes that haven't been approved yet, and then we'd still be recorded, it just may not be, it won't be live.
My instincts tell me that we'll probably get better attendance, potentially, if it's earlier, at least on the part of school stakeholders and certainly parents with young children.
Well, Richard, why don't we try it? And if you get a lot of complaints, will you let us know? That would be great. Okay. And Roby is not here to give us a CES update. Do you know anything? I do not.
I don't have anything from CES.
Okay. And Paul, you, do you have anything to tell us about building and grounds?
We will be meeting on the 29th from 3 to 5 p.m.
All right.
There we go. I'm not sure where we're
My office, in the superintendent's office, and that is an open meeting.
It is, yeah. I saw it posted on the website today, yeah. So I think the purpose there is really to refresh where we are from the 2012 design and talk about how to implement it.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Yeah.
And the only other thing I see, Annie, is that on the action item C, were we supposed to do something with program of studies for the middle school?
Mr. Beck, they're looking at creating a collaboration skills course for middle school students. Mr. Burgess is very interested in teaching kind of as an elective, team building, working with others, some great ideas. So when they've finalized that potential option as part of their study skills, that will come before the school.
Okay. All right. We are now down to the evaluation of the meeting and announcement of the next meeting. Any final thoughts or feedback?
This meeting was great.
Awesome. Efficient.
Just because it was short?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There's other reasons to think the meeting is good. But
this was a pretty good reason.
Yeah, it was good.
our English scores are up, our math scores
That's
are
right.
up.
That's
yeah.
right.
Love?
Yeah.
Right. Right. So we have our next meeting is July 27th. We're going to try the start of the meeting at 5:30. And we will wait to hear public feedback and Humira's feedback on that.
Thank you. Sounds good.
I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
What do I do with my time?
Second.
Wait.
Thank you. Oh.
Do we need to vote anything about it?
No,
you can announce it.
Because we announced it.
Got it.
On a roll call vote, again, Unit A contract, on a roll call vote, unanimously agreed to by school committee members.
Thank you.
All right, we are adjourned. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
See you on July 27th, if not before. Happy summer.